Welcome to Syntax.
Welcome to a brand new episode of the Front End Happy Hour podcast.
Welcome to this week's JS party.
Live from Shipshape Studios, this is Whiskey, Web, and Whatnot with your hosts, Robbie the Wagner and me, Charles William Carpenter III.
That's right, Charles. We drink whiskey and talk about web development. I mean, it's all in the name. It's not that deep.
This is Whiskey, Web, and Whatnot. Do not adjust your set.
Hey, everyone. We want to invite you to join us at All Things Open. All Things Open is the largest open source tech web conference on the U.S. East Coast. It's hosted annually in the heart of Research Triangle Park in downtown Raleigh, North Carolina. Target audiences include developers, engineers, decision makers, and open source community members, and anyone else involved with open source software. 4,000 to 5,000 people from all over the world are expected in October. We're going to be there. More information can be found online at 2024.allthingsopen.org. I really hope I don't have to spell that for you.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to our live Whiskey, Web, and Whatnot on location at Chuck's house, as you can see behind me.
That's right. Yeah.
This
I'm just back
Chuck's
in a different
house?
Room. Yes. Everybody came over and we had to just go into three different rooms because that's, you know, we need to stream it. Can't just record it locally.
We have to limit how much time we actually spend in the same room. So
yeah,
it's fine.
You know, we don't get along that well.
No,
it's really
never done this before. I don't even know you guys.
Yeah, well, we're the creepy guys on the internet that get your home address so we can mail you stuff.
That's
hopefully it works out.
But hey, when it ends up being whiskey, I'm not going to complain.
Right, right. It's a roll of the dice. Yeah, you ended up getting a free bottle of whiskey once too. Well, they're all free to you, but
the
you got an extra.
Bottle.
The oopsie bottle.
It's delicious.
Bardstown.
Yeah, actually, the whole reason we started a podcast was to collect a bunch of important tech people's home addresses so we can then sell those later. So,
I mean, it's working, right?
Yeah. I need to, but I have not sent a bag of dicks to anyone that I can recall.
I really think Ken Wheeler has
keep
to be
threatening.
The first.
Yeah, he would probably be the first, but not till after I go to his house because I've also been invited over for like a nice meal. So I don't want to send him a bag of dicks first and then be like, here I am. Please don't spit in my food.
Yeah. Speaking of dicks, would you like to intro?
Wow. That's a great segue.
Well, yeah, exactly. That was a pretty good one. But I know she's been on before. I know she's been on before. So save it. Save the rest.
Yeah. I guess we should let you intro yourself.
Introduce our
in case
guest.
People have not heard your previous episodes.
Yes. Hello. I am Kelly. I am director of engineering at a video intelligence startup called Spot AI. I've been in engineering for many, many years, engineering leadership for many years, but not as many as I've been coding. I live in Atlanta, and I, like Chuck, drive the same vehicle, except mine is not the wagon.
Yeah.
And that is the best way to explain it. That's me.
Snag and wagon. That's
nice.
You.
I was hoping that sentence was going to stop with just, I like Chuck.
That's it.
That'd be a good one.
Not
I
sure who this other guy
Robbie
is.
And yeah, I don't know. Does she ever text you, Robbie? Probably not. So.
Do we even have your number?
No,
I don't even know. I said we. I am one person. Yeah. But
Chuck does have my number. But
yeah, I have it.
I hope so.
It would be weird. Yeah, if I didn't have that, at least. Yeah, well, you know, if... You can just say offline. If you're interested, I'll send you his contact. If not, I totally understand. You know,
if not, we'll pretend this conversation never happened.
Yeah.
We'll cut it. No, I'm just kidding. We can't. It's live.
It's live.
All righty.
Well, we could cut it later, but if you rewatch the live footage, you'll... But anyway, continue. Sorry.
Did you want to finish your dick joke?
Speaking of
dicks.
This is
going to be the whole theme of this.
Can you tell us about the whiskey today?
All righty, fine. Fair enough. Okay, today we'll be enjoying chicken cock rye. I'm a child. It is 90 proof, aged 2 years with a mash bill of 95% rye and just 5% malted rye. The cool thing about this, aside from the bottle, so the bottle is really neat because it has this like chicken wire honeycomb texture to it. And apparently chicken cock is America's oldest whiskey brand, or
is
one
it
of.
Really?
It used to say. Yeah.
1856?
It's one of the oldest. Yeah.
In Paris, Kentucky. Seven decades later, it was a staple of Prohibition-era speakeasies. Okay, so a lot of illegal work there. Now it's back. The cock is back.
I love that if you stop reading at the second line, it's just established in 1856 in Paris.
Yeah. And then they're like, let's kind of go with
French
that.
Bourbon.
Yeah, yeah.
It's not even bourbon, it's rye.
Well, so the funny connection, though, is that you've had their bourbon. We were recording at Render a couple of years ago. Chicken cock bourbon became a little fun party, whatever. I can't remember who was on the episode where we actually tried it, but then you came by, we're hanging out, chicken cock.
You just got my recording of me saying chicken cock, yeah.
Yeah, we have that somewhere.
Now we have it again.
SD card. Yeah. Wait, what kind of is it?
I should just say it differently every time. This is chicken cook.
Say it in French since it's a French brand.
That would require me to know French.
Yeah, I don't know enough French despite having taken French.
Poulet.
Poulet is
chicken. And then
that's the best I can do.
I know the word for cock, believe it or not. And I learned French as a kid. You'd think cock would be on the list.
Yeah, that's one of the first words you want to learn.
Yeah. Okay, so on that note. Ooh, okay. This has a, it's almost like a cherry syrup or something smell to me.
Definitely smelling lime. Side.
It's got a what? A lime for you?
Yeah, I smell lime.
Puts the lime in the coconut. That's a song. I don't know if you were aware of that.
Wow.
Lime in the coconut. Yeah, it's a little weird. I think it's like some old 70s song. Put the lime in the coconut. No, never heard that?
That's actually the lyrics. They're in the,
Yeah. That's as far as I got, as far as memorizing them.
Yeah. It's by that guy that did that song?
Yeah. Yeah, guy who did song. Well, chat, who did the song? Nobody knows.
Is anyone in the chat? My computer is far away and I can't see.
Oh, that's true.
You can see
I don't think
chat.
So.
Hey, look, there's a chat.
There is. There's like, yeah. So there's live
stream
chat.
Jonathan.
Cyrus, if you know. Wow, Kelly. That's what Cyrus says. It's not Billy Ray. Don't worry about it.
Wow. It's fine.
So, okay, let's get back to the whiskey. Yes, it has a sweeter, almost like cola. It's almost like cola syrup a little bit to me the more I smell it. Now I'm going to taste it. See what happens here. Yeah, still a little bit of that. Like if I was to have like a very syrupy, like cherry Pepsi, a little bit of that.
Yes, but it's very thin.
Yeah, but it's like a flat cherry Pepsi in the beginning, and then you get a little bit of like bitterness, citrusy bitterness.
It's kind of like Pepsi mixed with 7-Up. Like you made a suicide and then like shook it all up to where it wasn't fizzy and like didn't taste good and just had like not that much soda flavor, I guess, like subtleness.
Okay.
You're going to give this a very high rating, I can tell.
He's very much enjoying it.
I think this is okay. I said a not good tasting soda, I didn't necessarily mean this was bad.
So that's a multi-generational term too. I didn't realize. I remember as a grade school kid or whatever, we'd go to roller skating parties and that was the fun thing to get like a soda cup and make a suicide, which was just basically everything that was there all mixed together.
Oh.
Yeah. But,
yeah. I don't know if... dear listener, if you'd ever heard that term before, I didn't know if it was a Midwest in the early 80s kind of thing.
I don't know about that, but I do know that, you know, living in Atlanta, we have Coca-Cola headquartered here. And at the World of Coke, there's a whole room that has every single Coke product from around the world.
Oh, wow.
And there are people who actually try to taste every single thing. And most often end up sick at the end because...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That tracks.
But there's one from Italy, I believe. It's called the Beverly. And everyone talks about how bad it is because it's so bitter. But I only ever had it as a kid. And now I'm wondering if I were to try it now as an adult, like how close is it to like Campari or, you know, something that is already like a bitter liqueur that could be good.
Yeah.
I could also be horribly wrong. I should have tried it while I was in Italy and I did not even think about it.
Yeah. And I was there like a month.
You were.
Yeah. I didn't do a lot of soda, but I like Campari and Amaros in general. So I like that bitterness.
Yeah.
I'm thinking like I will even sometimes just have a little bit of Campari with like a splash of soda in it. Just that is actually pretty tasty.
They had like a Campari soda like in a can there.
Oh, yes, yes.
All the time.
And the little bottles. Yes.
They're so good. Oh, yeah, the little bottles. You're right, man. Good times in Italy. Minus totally eating it and having to withdraw from the Chicago Marathon. But outside of that,
Yeah.
You know, if I ignore the ankle pain, we're good.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you could take some of those Campari sodas and take the edge off of said ankle pain.
The edge was taken off.
Yeah, perfect. Okay.
I kind of injured myself halfway through vacation, and so I had walked on a very sprained ankle for a week.
Womp, womp. Well, on the road to recovery, as you post frequently, and some of those posts being post runs.
Yes, I'm running again. That is good. I had a really tough physical therapy session on Friday, and so my ankle is not feeling great still, which is the longest it's ever hurt for a while. But I did go on a 4-mile run yesterday because I was in Michigan and it was 55 degrees outside. I'm like, I have to run outside in that kind of weather. Like, it's beautiful. It was worth it. It was worth a little bit of pain at the end.
Sounds like about the same temperature as where Chuck is right now.
Like in this room, it might be 55 degrees in this room. Like, we have a thing in Arizona, and when it goes above 100 degrees, that means all the inside should be like 60 degrees. So it doesn't make any sense. I have this sweatshirt sitting right here next to me because half the time I'm in here freezing.
We call that women's winter. Because like when it gets really hot outside and they dial down the temperature inside buildings, I always, always bring another layer.
Yeah. Because you can guarantee it's just going to be freezing all over the place, no matter where you go. And if you're spending more than 15 minutes in any of those spaces, it's like, hell no. Women's winter. Not heard that before.
Look, we're already learning things.
We are learning things. This is good. I like where this is going. Let's learn what you think of this whiskey. Okay, so a reminder for everyone, the highly technical scale of 0 to 8 tentacles, 0 being terrible, you spit this out, which I didn't happen to notice, but maybe. 4, middle of the road, not bad. 8, amazing, clear the shelves. You're an expert, Kelly, in this particular, this is like at least your third time rating something, so
yes,
you know what's up. Let's see if Robbie has an opinion. I think he's going to like this one, but.
Yeah. Yeah, in terms of chicken cocks, this is maybe not the best one I've had, but in terms of general rise.
Please take that one little bit. That's a perfect.
Yeah, in terms of chicken cocks.
It's not the best one I've had.
Yeah. It's okay. Anyway, I think in terms of rise, it's not terrible. It's not great. It's like, it's kind of middle of the road for me. I don't really have anything like super negative to say about it, but I'm not like, I don't love it, and I don't have like super opinionated reasons why. But so for that reason, I'm just going to give it a 5.
Okay.
5 is more generous than I thought you would go.
I was going to go with a 5.5.
Okay.
Because we have a half tentacle in here today. I don't think I can give it a 6, but my brain went right to 5.5 on the scale of 0 to 8. So
interesting.
I would. All right. Obviously, you could see I definitely have not had this much of it today.
Are you sure?
Oh, I've already been drinking.
You know,
it.
This is the most Monday of Wednesdays.
Oh, it's such a Monday for so many reasons that I'm not going to talk about on here. That's for afterward. We stop recording.
Okay. All right.
I have a great story, but it's not getting recorded.
It's not for everyone. Okay. That's fair enough. See, I feel like I'm leaning more towards middle of the road, and I want this to be better. Because the branding is obviously funny and I'm a child. Yeah. The bottles are nice, like with this nice like texture on it. I really like that. I like the ideology behind the brand. And it's been a little while. It's funny that I haven't tried any other ones. But so I really liked the bourbon that we had.
I was going to say, yeah.
And I know they have a few different expressions. I should kind of dig into it more. But I already have a drinking problem. And so it's just like, do you need to just a new one every week, probably just go with that. But I feel like it's a 4, maybe 4.5 at most. Okay. For me, for a rye, this really just doesn't have the qualities that you're looking for in a rye. Like, honestly, if I blindly had this, I'd be like, I don't know, it's a less sweet bourbon in a way.
Yes.
And it's just like, it's kind of one note in a way. Like, I'm getting that like little bit of flat cola, little bit of citrus, and then it kind of goes away. I think that's what I'm not loving about it. So it's like, I'd probably try this in a cocktail. Like, it might make an interesting Sazerac where you get some more other notes in there and still leave it somewhat naked. But, 4.5. I'll be nice. 4.5 just because I like what else they've done so far.
Okay.
Yeah. Mm. I mean, not every whiskey can perform every time. So it's
just like many. Oh, my gosh. And the irony is that it's both whiskey and I'll leave it at that.
I'm gonna stop now. I promise.
Yeah, you're actually being a little rude.
Okay. All right.
Anyway, we're gonna do some hot takes, but they are adjusted from what we normally would do for you, Kelly, because A, you don't give a shit about React. Here's my spicy one. For a race car, Miata or Boxster?
I'm going to say Miata.
It's the wrong answer.
The reason why is because I don't race. My husband does the racing. It's way more friendly on my budget. Because after taking the Cayman out on the track so many times, you just blow through tires, you blow through brakes, and it gets expensive. But Miata, way cheaper. Now, I'm not going to say no to Boxster. Actually, yeah. I just want to buy a Boxster as like a second daily, but I think I don't have room for another car right now. So
yeah, you need those like those lift things, yes. Whatever, the double load. Yeah, but
my garage is too small for those, and so we're going to have to buy a new house first. So
house more cars.
Commitment.
I like this thinking though. This is good. Yeah, I support this decision.
Yes, or as Cyrus says, put the car in the living room.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's like those apartments where you would like, you could drive it into the elevator and like it goes up with you.
Yes.
And then you just like get in the car and go down. Sounds kind of cool.
I actually currently have a 2024 Macan outside because I have my Taycan in for, I just hit 20K miles. So I just did my 20K mile service and then I'm taking care of some recalls. So
nice.
I've been driving a base level Macan. With an upgraded, it's a premium package in the upgraded surround sound system. So, I mean, it's cozy. Decent. It's, I mean, you could tell that it's the base Macan. And
yeah.
After renting a CX-5 for 24 hours in Detroit, I'd take the Macan any day, but that's probably obvious.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. I'd rather have a base like, Macan than a fully loaded Acura or something, you know? Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Like after, when you drive a Taycan all the time, when you drive an electric vehicle all the time, you're just used to the torque. Like, it's always there. You're just going to go. And I'm like, you know, that meme with the stick poking. And I'm like, do something. That's how I feel when I'm driving the CX-5. And I owned two Mazda 3s. Loved them. Also, those were like my last manual vehicles again because it's fine. But I love my car. I'm going to eventually buy a 1990 911, a 964. It's going to be amazing. It's a perfect complement to a Taycan.
Yeah, I think so. You need some more explosions still, you know.
Yes.
And they're in the back, so it's fairly safe.
It's fairly safe.
That's true.
There are other years that I could get, but as I think we discussed, you know, I value my life and I do want to live.
Yeah.
So we're going with a 964.
Yeah, an 80s like 930. Is like they call them the Widowmaker.
Exactly. There's a reason why it's called the Widowmaker.
Yeah. Yeah.
Have they all exploded a lot?
No. It's just that they're super light and a lot of power and like you have
easy to
work
crash.
Your way up into. Yeah. They're just basically easy to crash. So
I like these new versions of hot takes, by the way.
Yeah. Well, we got to mix it up. You know, it can be like get push or, you know, no. Get push, get pull, whatever.
Neither of those
Remix
or Merge was what it was, but anyway.
Yeah, no, I know what it was, but it's funnier. So you don't
get push or get pull.
People are going to think that I just don't code. Like I don't know how the internet
all
works.
All I know is you're just supposed to go get push dash F.
Dash F.
Yeah.
Every time. Just get push.
Especially if you're on the wrong branch and you don't realize it. That's when you really
doesn't matter.
Do it.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Get push main. Because we're politically correct.
Yeah, I've had a problem recently where I always click the pull button. I use Tower at work, like the Git client. And I press that every time to make sure I'm up to date. But if you haven't pushed your branch yet, its default is to take the main branch and merge it into yours when you do that. And I'm like, I never, ever want that to happen. What is going on?
Yeah, what is the setting here?
Yeah.
It's a choice.
Yeah. It's a choice to use that. That well, app at all, but
wow, Chuck's a Git purist, like CLI or bust.
I have PTSD from like learning Git from senior engineers that were like neckbeards eating Funyuns, like yelling at me and throwing like their old Mountain Dew 2 liters at my face. So
I'm going to say they probably did not throw their 2 liters at your face.
They were empty.
But did they throw it at your face?
Do you think any of that was literally what happened, Robbie? Like, are there parts that you'd like to dig into it, Inspector Gadget? Or,
I mean, what I want to take away from that is I have not eaten a Funyun in a very long time.
Yeah.
I think Funyuns are underrated.
I completely agree.
I think you're right. I agree. I think Funyuns were delicious. I think they still exist. I have no idea.
Yeah, they have Flamin' Hot ones now, which I am
Flamin' Hot Funyuns?
Mm-hmm.
Now that's a party.
Yep.
That's a solo party, possibly.
Yeah.
Oh, man. All right. Well, get to your hot take, Robert.
Oh, okay. We are in football season now. So if you had to pick Georgia or Michigan?
Michigan.
Oh, that was easier than I thought. Okay.
I have had to explain my upbringing and my college affiliation to so many people at this point that, yes, I am a fan of both Michigan and Georgia. I grew up in Michigan. My earliest memories are tailgating for Michigan games. I'm a big U of M fan. I also have 3 degrees from the University of Georgia, which means I, by the amount of money I have paid the University of Georgia, am also a Georgia fan.
Right. Yeah.
I think
they're a fan of you.
Their
alumni association is. How about keep it coming?
3 weeks into grad school, and I went straight from undergrad to grad school. I was maybe 3 weeks in. The alumni, like, they started calling me, asking me to donate. I'm like, do you want me to pull up my latest tuition bill? Because I'm still here. Yeah, I'm still exactly. giving you plenty of money.
We're going to be okay.
But yeah, they are ruthless about that.
This is going to be an interesting football season, though. I'm not sure with the reorganization of divisions, like of conferences, and then the extended number of playoff teams. I'm just very interested in seeing how it'll go. The four team model, I understand why that needed to change. Like, it's always SEC or Michigan.
Yeah, when you have the same four teams like 10 years in a row, it's probably not the best model. Yeah.
But it's also fun watching Florida just like cry a little. It's also fun watching Alabama be like, well, we don't have Nick Saban and we lost a bunch of people and we have a different coach from where we had last year. And so we're going to see how things go. I would love to see them fail. Unfortunately, this is recorded, but I think Ohio State is going to do well this year.
Oh, no. Okay. That's all the time we have, I think.
I'm not rooting for them. Trust me.
We are drinking.
The only team I like less than Alabama is Ohio State.
Ohio State is like, the way I think about it is like Alabama is a dynasty. Like they are supposed to be good and fine. Okay. If you want to be like, hey, we're good. Yes, you are good. Ohio State is trash and thinks they're good, recruits a couple people. They're the, like, I think we might have even said this the last time we talked to you, that they're the react of football teams. It's this self-fulfilling prophecy of like people use it because other people use it. So it's like they were ranked and good, which made them get recruits. So they faked being good to then be good, which, like, I guess props to them for doing that. But like, I don't like them and I don't like their philosophy.
I would probably say that Alabama is more the react. I feel like they're like the staple team that a lot of people support if you're like in the Southeast and not in, you know, a Georgia fan, basically. Ohio State is, I'm trying to think about which is like the really annoying one that's just like occasionally be like, oh, look why you're so much better than React, and then everyone forgets about them. Oh, look what, you know, we're so much better than React, you should move to this, and then everyone forgets about them. They're the shiny objects.
So many of those.
Exactly.
You or Nuxt or whatever kind of has had a, I feel like they've all had a little dalliance with that where they released something and people were like, oh, there's something to that.
Yeah.
But I get paid to do this, so I'm going to stick over there.
And that's why we are all learning React.
Except for
Robbie. Unfortunately, I think most people in the chat are not into football or college football.
Yeah, college football, very specific. It's a very
Chuck has got them all on European football. He doesn't play this egg ball game stuff, so.
I don't, yeah. And where I grew up, like, football really wasn't that big of a deal. Like, well, we had, I don't live there, but whatever, the Bengals. And, like, that was a fun thing I might do once a year to, like, go hang out and live sporting events, super fun. I don't care. I'll go to like pretty much anything.
Yeah.
But didn't follow at all. Basketball is very big in the Cincinnati area. We have the University of Kentucky, University of Louisville, Cincinnati, where I went. Yeah, I mean, Ohio State was even pretty decent for a while, all of those. So it's like basketball was kind of it. And then people played soccer, and I just kind of stuck with that. It's just all about my long-going European dreams.
I never got into basketball, mostly because my first exposure to basketball. I went to a lot of Michigan basketball games because my grandparents worked for U of M, and so we just, like, honestly, I never really appreciated it because we would just, like, walk right onto the floor because my grandparents worked there. And I just, like, never really registered that.
You didn't know your privilege
exactly.
At the time.
And then pro, growing up in Michigan, I didn't have Pistons. Much going for me with the Pistons.
Right, yeah. Like, it predates you, you know, where, what were they called? The Bad Boys or something?
They were
like that?
Good before I was born.
Right, yeah. Big Isaiah Thomas fan. He showed up at your birth. It was great. Would you ever live in Michigan again?
No.
Would you consider living now?
I like my winters.
Summer house in Traverse City.
Mm. I love visiting again. Like, even when I go up in September or I go up in the spring or summertime, like, basically anything except, like, from December, like, after Christmas until May. That's just Michigan's dead to me.
Fair enough.
Michigan's dead to everybody. Or,
fair weather
unfortunately.
Fan.
Unfortunately.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I enjoy when springtime hits in March and then I'm watching my family be like, yeah, we're about to get a blizzard again.
Yeah.
I mean, Cincinnati, like.
Similar. Yeah. We used to say, if you don't like the weather, just wait till tomorrow.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I've come to learn that everybody says that.
Yeah. It turns out, I don't know who started it, but it spread like wildfire.
It did. Same thing as like the your 11 seasons of the year. We just, you know, a couple weeks ago, we had fake fall, which is a fantastic week.
I loved
week.
That. It was great.
So nice. And then immediately back to 90s. And I'm just like, nope, bring it back. Bring it back. Yeah. And that is how fake fall works.
Right.
Gets you excited and then just like rips off the band-aid.
You like pull out some of your sweaters or a jacket for nighttime
something.
Yeah.
And unfortunately for me, fake fall coincided with the release of the pumpkin drinks, the fall drinks at Starbucks.
Mm.
And so I was all ready with my pumpkin spice turtleneck and my cold brew and it was like 70 degrees outside. And I'm like, yeah, let's do this. And then immediately just like rolled up the sleeves.
Right, yeah, because you're like 70 isn't quite 50.
Yeah, but again, I went inside a building and I was like, okay, sleeves back down.
That's why they can serve you those pumpkin spice lattes or whatever, because they're like, come on in, it's cold in here.
Exactly.
It feels a little bit like how, you know, Walgreens or whatever, they'll put their, I feel like we've had the Halloween decorations out for like a month already.
Oh, yeah.
And you're like,
they got
yeah.
Christmas stuff out like months ago.
Oh my God.
I think I saw some Christmas stuff at Home Depot recently.
Yeah.
It's never too early. Like, I think we're getting the stuff for like Christmas 2025 out now as well.
Right. Yeah. We better get that out because, you know, the trends are changing. Those like white trees are coming back for 2025. Not this year. Don't buy it ahead of time. But,
yeah.
Yeah.
If you buy it this year, it's too soon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This just in, Whiskey.fund is now open for all your merch needs. That's right, Robbie. We're hearing reports of hats, sweaters, and t-shirts, as well as a link to join our Discord server. What's a Discord server? Just read the prompter, man. Hit subscribe, leave us a review on your favorite podcast app, and tell your friends about our broadcast. It really does help us reach more people and keeps the show growing. All right, back to your regularly scheduled programming.
So I'm going to say I added a couple of drops of water and it, I don't know, it helped and gave it a little bit of diversity, like a little bit of spice in the finish. I don't know. It's not amazing, but it did help some.
Yeah. The more I drink it, the better it gets.
Yeah, that's usually how alcohol works.
A lot of things work out that way. My body is like, is it Wednesday? Is it Monday? I don't know. You do this all the time.
Hey, I'm at the beach, so.
Yeah,
yeah. Doesn't matter. Go ahead, rub it in a little bit more.
Yeah. I thought that was a fake background behind you, but I guess it's real.
No, yeah. That's the real beach.
Yeah, that's right outside. Wait, that's right outside my back balcony.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, you forgot. Yeah.
Yeah, but I remember. It's the drinking, you know. I'm trying to catch up to Kelly because, you know, I haven't had as much as
she's
had.
Oh, you're doing good. Like, keep on. You're almost
getting there.
We're getting there. I'm trying to play catch up some. So, Robbie's on it and whatever else.
All right. Speaking of places we're getting to, let's talk about Raleigh and all things open.
Yes.
Yeah, we have not been before. Have you been before?
I have not, because it's almost always the week of my birthday. And this year, it is the week before my birthday.
Oh, excellent.
So I get to enjoy it and then still get back in time for my birthday weekend.
And do other things, yes. That sounds like
we can still celebrate my birthday. Like, that's totally fine.
While there, you're okay with this? Okay.
I will give you permission to celebrate my birthday.
Nice.
Thank you.
Okay. There might be alcohol involved. I don't know. You know, it's there kind of on brand. Yeah. Not that I want to drink, but I just, you know, have to. I've got this image to keep, and so.
I will also be actively half marathon training, so that'll be fun. Nice little mix of alcohol and running in the morning at 5 a.m. It's fine.
Yeah. Yeah, no, totally fine.
Yeah, well, I'll be skipping that running part.
Yeah, I was gonna say, I would love to join you. I think I am going to be injured.
You're gonna schedule an injury.
Yeah, I definitely have an upcoming injury scheduled for that week. Otherwise, I totally would.
You know, I get it. It happens. Sometimes I'll be like, yeah, my ankle's just hurting too much this morning. I better not work out. It's the best excuse.
Or go down and do kind of a recumbent bike, and they have the screens on there, and you know, you find something mediocre to watch. Yeah, that's a good way to do it.
Since Peloton introduced the Kindle app in the entertainment section on the bike and on the tread, I have worked out more in the past week and a half than I have in quite some time, because I love reading. And also, like, if I get on the bike, I will just stay there. And next thing I know, like, an hour has gone by. And I am finally going to get off of here and realize that I have definitely not had enough to eat for as much as I'm cycling right now. But that's the best part. Yeah. Then I just get to eat.
Nice. Yeah, I am curious how many people use that, though. I feel like, having not tried it and not really being a reader myself, it sounds incredibly hard to bike and read, but maybe it's not.
I don't really know. No, it's not that big of a deal. Like, because, you mean, you're staying pretty steady. I mean, you should be staying pretty steady. Otherwise, you're moving way too much as you're on this bike. And it's not like you're, like, actively getting up and down and moving around and everything. Like, you're changing the resistance and, like, that's it. You might adjust your cadence, but your upper body should be pretty still the entire time. Now, running, on the other hand, I would not try running and reading at the same time. Walking and reading is probably enough for me. And I'll just, like, hit the treadmill to, like, 10% incline and 3 miles per hour and just, like, walk. It's great. Yeah.
I do think they should, what they should do is have all the Peloton people read us books. So, like, I want some Alex Toussaint reading me something.
Good night, like, moon.
Yeah. And then just take a nap.
It's both a workout class and meditation. That's great.
Yeah, that's kind of a win-win. I do like the Peloton rowing workouts. I don't have a Peloton rower, but I have a rower.
I do.
And you have the full collection.
I have
you
the trifecta.
Can you read and row?
No, I don't think it's on there. Because you have to flip the pages yourself. And so your hands are
and there's no way you can be like, hold on here. But Matt, whatever his name is, the rowing instructor. I really like that guy.
Matt Wilbers?
He's got some cool. Yeah.
Oh, man. Maybe? He's fantastic. He's a Georgia boy, too.
Yeah. Oh, I see. Well, then that's clearly why we get along. He doesn't know me, but we're definitely friends.
I mean, same. Yeah. My friend's husband went to high school with him, and that's the weird connection that the levels removed.
Yeah. And he was like a college rower and all this stuff. And he puts together some good mixes. I'm like, yeah. Okay. We're aligned on this. The most I've ever done is I have watched some shows while rowing. Like, if I know I'm just going to, like, okay, I'm going to just bust out a 2K or something. Let's watch some thing while this is happening. I can do that.
I may have talked about this last time we did this, and that I'll turn on All Too Well 10-minute version.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, because after you're done listening, 10 minutes have gone by. It's easy math.
Yeah.
Exactly. You want to do a 30-minute workout, listen to it 3 times.
Nice. Yeah. I have a new potential Taylor Swift connection that is not actually a connection, but I can dream. So the Kelsey Brothers podcast is signed a deal with Wondery, and I work for Art19, which is where Wondery hosts all their stuff. So, like, Taylor Swift could theoretically walk by and see a website I made at some point. Like,
yeah, that's
a website I made.
It's not the flex you think it is. I don't know.
Hey, what do you got, Chuck?
It just reminds me of a funny thing. I don't know if you watched Friends or not or whatever. You remember how Ross and Rachel, if you did, you may remember Ross and Rachel had their list of celebrities that they were allowed to have, like, a pass for. And there's this, like, Ross is really, you know, he's painstaking over it. And whether, what was her name? There was an actress that it was like whether she would be on or off, and she didn't make the final list, and he laminated it, and then he ended up meeting her and then stupidly tells her the story. But anyway, blah, 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 blah. We used to make the jokes that we also have a list of celebrities that would be permissible. And there was a couple of different times in life where I would like have 6 degrees of separation, like worked with someone at National Geographic who grew up in the same neighborhood as Rachel McAdams, and then like were like kind of family friends. And I was like, that's a few degrees separation. Okay. And she's on the list. Yeah. It's stuff, funny stuff like that.
My
had a couple of those. That was it.
Degrees of separation to Taylor is, you know, her album Lover. The photography for that album, yes, I know that album. The photography for that album was done by, the co-working space that I used to work at for 5 years. One of the baristas there, her best friend, did the photo shoot for it. And so she helped with the photo shoot as well. And so that's a pretty close connection.
That's a pretty close connection.
Yeah. Take it.
Yeah. You should have been on tour. That's what the end of that should have been you were invited on tour. And there we go. And that was a great year of your life.
Oh, man, that would have been great. But no, I'm not that special. That's my early retirement plan, is to just follow Taylor Swift's tour. It's fine.
Nice.
I'll have money, hopefully, or I'll just spend all my money that year, because by the time she tours again, it's going to be like $10,000 for a ticket.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Why so little?
Why so little?
And still sell out in 35 seconds or less. 100%.
Yeah, we'll absolutely always sell out. We're going to our company offsite next week, and there's going to be an opportunity for others to kind of give talks. I was joking that I'm going to give a stack ranking of every single Taylor Swift song that has ever come out, and I'm going to need 3 hours. It's going to take me some time.
Yeah, to like work through each one and your reasoning.
Would be extensive.
And
yeah,
that's pretty serious. Yeah.
So I do want to steer us back for just a second. This is great Whatnot.
This is
We not really say a lot about all things open. I do want to say we'll all be there. We'll be drinking and podcasting there. You'll be speaking there.
Yes.
Can you give us any kind of preview into what you'll be talking about?
Yes. I'm pretty sure. I submitted my talk. We did this a long time ago. The talk I'm giving right now is probably the talk that I'm giving there. So I'm going to go with it. It's called Influence Without Authority. So the idea of this talk is, no matter where you are in your career, you can have influence within your organization. So a lot of people believe like you have to have the manager title in order to have any impact on your org and be able to make a change. And this talk is really kind of breaking that idea down, saying, actually, here are all the ways that you can build influence within your organization, like very tactical ways of like building relationships and asking for and providing feedback, asking why more often, helping to kind of justify something or present something, talking about managing up, like proposing your ideas and how to get those to be heard and understood and like accepted. You know, not everything you say is going to be accepted, as we all know, but you know, a lot of people are afraid of giving their suggestions altogether, or they're so bad at it that they just don't get their point across. And I think that's one of the biggest issues that a lot of individual contributors have earlier on in their career. Even, you don't have to be early on in your career. I think this is one of the skills that a lot of people don't have, or basically they go into their reasoning for something before they've even talked about what their goal is. Like, they're trying to set the stage for what they're going to talk about. And when you're managing up, it's the opposite. You need to tell me, what is it that you want? Why do you want it? And what happens if you don't get it? And that's a good way of like a very truncated version of that section, because I think that alone is a skill that everybody can build and everybody should build. Whether it is a professional relationship, it is a friendship, like a personal relationship in any form, like dealing with kids, dealing with parents, whatever it happens to be, like that is a very good rule to follow. If they want more details, they'll ask for more details, but don't assume everybody wants the unabridged version. They want the very, very, like, give me the table of contents. Give me the TLDR.
Yeah, that's true. I feel like I've fallen into that trap with like a few documents I've written and stuff that like I'm used to, like, I don't write a lot of documents necessarily. And like, you know, in school, they want you to use like flowery language and like, you know, all this like extra detail. And it's like, just cut out like 90% of your sentences and just talk about like what you want to do. And it's like, oh, okay, that's way different than I thought it should be, but that kind of makes sense.
Exactly. I find when I'm doing document writing, start with a goal. Like, here's the goal of this document in the first place. Then I'm going to create the table of contents before I've written anything else. And then I'm going to look at the table of contents and be like, what is actually important here? I'm going to write those sections first. And then I'm going to go back and be like, all right, do I need these other sections, or can I add them as an appendix? And then I'll just like move them down.
Nice. It's a good strategy.
Yeah. When you help Robbie get a promotion, he's going to send you a nice gift.
Oof.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's enough help in the world for that at this point.
But, Start your professional therapy. Well, you know, there is a program called the Friend Zone.
Yes.
I mean, if you want to sell some shit, Kelly, go ahead.
Yes. So I recently started a new community with my friend Taylor Dessen called the Friend Zone. And basically, the whole goal of this is to help you get a job and to network with others who are also job hunting right now, and to give you that opportunity to figure out how you can, you know, really position yourself to get that interview, to nail that interview. There's a lot of competition out there right now. Obviously, people are still getting laid off. It's taking people a long time to get their job after getting laid off. You know, I'm reviewing some resumes right now that they've been unemployed for 8, 9, 10, 11, 12 months. And they've been looking for a role this entire time. And I'm obviously not faulting them for that. But it's tough. It's really tough when you need some kind of support. So we have a free option where you can join the community. It's on Discord, and you can chat with other job seekers. We post jobs in there, just little tips here and there. But we do have three paid tiers as well. The first tier is going to get you access to a monthly call with us where we review LinkedIn profiles and resumes. You get additional channels. You get extra access to jobs where, like, Taylor and I have connections. Taylor has been in the recruiting space for a long time. I'm a hiring manager, which is why we know this stuff front and back. We interview a lot of people. And then as you add on to those two other tiers that we have, so three tiers total, you get additional perks with that. You can look at their website to actually break it down all of it. I'm not going to give you the entire breakdown on here, but it's thefriendzone.lol. It's a great, great
domain.
Pretty
great. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which tier do you get the NFTs?
That's in tier 4.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah. I saw something on Threads yesterday. Basically, somebody was like, yeah, we should put everybody front and center who bought an NFT and who was like advocating for NFTs at the time. And I was like, man, go ahead and permanently affix my non-fungible Olive Garden NFT that I bought to my profile, because that was the best.
Olive Garden had one?
No, it was not. And that's why it got shut down. Because I owned an Olive Garden in Kentucky. It was basically it. It was priced $29, I think it was, because it was the same price as unlimited soup, salad, and breadsticks.
Yeah, which is, by the way, the best thing on the menu. I will.
Yes.
It's 100%
salad
what
is
you
fire.
Should get.
Oh, the salad is so good.
Yeah, soup, salad, and breadsticks. The salad
I'm really
is
hungry right now.
Ooh, sorry.
This is a challenging conversation.
I'm about to have this 10 helps. Pounds of crab legs here in a little bit. So
okay.
Let's go.
Nice. Yeah. It's probably not going to go quite like that for me, but I would tear up some breadsticks and salad and everything. It's definitely by far the best thing, and I will go back there just to get that.
Oh, it's so good.
Oh, yeah.
And
yeah,
you know,
the pasta is kind of mid, to be honest.
It is.
But the salad is fire.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. The pasta fagioli, good. There's a zuppa toscana, is the potato one, I think, or something.
I used to make really zuppa toscana all the time, like that soup. It's so good.
It is.
Now I'm just too lazy.
I'm glad it still hits, though. Like, I had it in this past year.
Okay.
We're on some kind of road trip. And, you know, you're looking at the options, and we're like, yeah, let's just do that. Let's go with it. And it still worked. The wine was like piss, but everything else was great.
Olive Garden was peak middle class fancy for me.
Yeah, for sure.
Like, it was such a privilege to go to Olive Garden. I grew up in a small town, so we didn't have much. You had to drive, you know, at least 20, 25 minutes to get to the local Olive Garden.
Right.
So I was very excited whenever I had an opportunity to eat Olive Garden. And now I cannot remember the last time I went to Olive Garden. I'm spoiled for choice in Atlanta, though. So
Yeah. I mean, you know, all things equal, it's like not that. It's definitely like not a thing you're going to seek out very often.
Yeah.
I can't. Yeah, I don't go to many chain restaurants in general.
When was the last time you went to a Waffle House, though?
I don't know, but I want to go now after you posted this morning.
I went very recently, like a couple weeks ago, and it'd been the first time I'd been to Waffle House in years. And
oh, really?
I don't need to go into the super deep details, but I was with somebody who they had a procedure, and so I was taking care of them, and I had to drive them because obviously they're going under for that. And apparently when they woke up, the first thing they said was Waffle House.
Wow. Smothered so I was like, and covered? All right. I mean, yeah. Smothered and covered all day long, for sure.
Exactly. Oh, scattered, smothered, yeah. And covered. They have chicken sausage now.
Okay.
It was actually really tasty. So okay. My go-to order, because I have a go-to order at Waffle House, even though I don't go all the time. I used to, right. When I lived in Athens, when I was at UGA, I used to have to walk through downtown to get to where I worked at the other side of downtown. And so I'd always stop at Waffle House on the way, and I'd order an egg and cheese sandwich on Raisin Toast.
That's okay.
Sounds interesting.
It's kind of so like good. OG McGriddle in a way, right? Like with a little sweet on the outside.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You got to try it. It's very good.
Try it. I'm open to that.
I was like, so afraid like that I was going to order it and it was just not going to be good anymore, because I'm like holding this in my heart that it's always going to be good.
Yeah.
And it's exactly the same. So I'm very happy.
I'm going to guess that's not what Robbie got. He has a tendency.
No, there's not enough calories in that for me. So I get the all-star with all the things. I get ham. Or actually, so my wife doesn't eat meat. So like she gets the... Yes, I know. She gets the bacon and I get the ham, so I get both. And then
that's a good relationship.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then I get eggs, hash browns, smothered, covered, chunked, and capped.
Ooh.
And blueberry waffle. And I don't eat the toast because I'm watching my weight. So
yeah, yeah. I'm can't like, have the why toast. Have the empty calories for nothing?
Yeah.
When I was in high school, I used to split the all-star meal with a friend of mine. That's we always did when we went there together. We'd always split the all-star meal. So I get
nice.
It.
Nice.
It's a good one.
Yeah.
It's a good one. And it's all cheaper than like a coffee and pastry from Starbucks, which doesn't make
yes.
any sense.
It was, well, I mean, in high school, it was like $5.99. I don't know what it is now.
It's like $10, but still, it's
inflation.
Cheaper than,
yeah. Yeah. It'll get you.
It was great being able to feed myself and a friend for, you know, $3 each on our lowly high school budgets.
Wait, before we get too far off. Any advice on starting a newsletter? So as media moguls that Robbie and I are, we're looking at different ways to expand the empire. And we think starting a newsletter might be a good way to do that.
I'm a big fan of newsletters. I have two of them. So you know I'm having fun. Newsletters only grow so much as you actually market them. So that's the first thing. And honestly, it's something I've not been very good at lately. My newsletter yesterday that I published on burnout is probably the most promotion that I've gotten out of a newsletter in a very long time. But what I would recommend doing is what used to work before, where you can be like, oh, here's a referral program and refer all your friends and they're going to sign up. Doesn't work anymore. Nobody wants to do that. You're going to have more luck if you want to get people to sign up is offer something for free to them. That could be a download. That could be whatever makes sense for you. Discount. But that's usually for marketing, for like e-commerce, for example.
We got some free NFTs.
Free NFTs. There we go. You Perfect. Can listen to this live podcast that has been recorded in the past. Yes. Really, really
it
great.
It was live. And it's not a total lie. It was
I'm
live.
I'm going to... Yes, Cyrus, a small free PDF for free. It's actually going to be just like a blank PDF. Like you didn't ask for any content.
It just says PDF.
It's a PDF. Here's a picture of a PDF.
It's just the PDF icon.
That's it. Yes.
Yeah. Or it's a picture of Robbie like going like this.
Yeah. Exactly.
It's a GIF, which, you know, Siri says GIF correctly, just so you know. GIF, yeah.
GIF is the right way to say it. Anyone who says otherwise is wrong. GIF is for peanut butter.
I'm wrong then. That's fine.
Yes. Robbie's wrong in so many ways, though, you know, like.
Yeah.
That's we'll add it to the list. It's fine.
Yeah. It's just like.
Yeah. The other thing I'll say about newsletters is be consistent. Pick a cadence and stick with it. And don't try to overdo it or else you will lose track of where you're at and you'll fall off. And I started weekly on mine and then I was like, I can't keep up with this. And so I switched to biweekly. And then I was like, I can't keep up with this. And so I stopped publishing altogether. And now I'm back twice weekly, actually. My Tuesday newsletter is free. And then my Friday newsletter is for premium subscribers only. I tease it for the free people, but then the paid subscribers get to read the entire thing. And it's like a longer version of Tuesday's newsletter, basically. So given that I just wrote about burnout and it was a really good topic, Friday's is also very good.
So if you choose to subscribe, now is a good time.
That's right.
I'm a leech unto your content. I sign up for all the free shit, for sure.
I appreciate that. Modernleader.is is that one. The other newsletter I have is called Tiny Triumphs. I'm really big on very small productivity tips. I read Atomic Habits every single year. It's like, that's how I roll. So basically, I've created a newsletter of every weekday morning, 7 a.m., you get a tip, very small tip in your inbox.
Just the tip.
Just a tip. Keeping it on, you know, we're good. We're good. Yeah, I love that one. It's easy. And I definitely like load up on the content, and I have all my content ready through end of September.
Nice. Very good. Nice. Yeah, I do love the small tips email. Yeah. I find it very useful. I only had that joke was top of mind for me because I watched the Vince Vaughn Hot Ones the other day. He was talking about
a new show or movie or something.
Yeah, Bad Monkey or something like that on Apple TV. You'll never hear about it because they don't market anything. But
I'll still watch it. If it's on Apple, yeah, I watch it.
And he's very funny and obviously in like the Hot Ones, just off the cuff. But the question was like, what do fans like run up to you quoting and whatever else? And what are some deeper quotables that you don't hear that much that you really like or something like that? So Just the Tip was one of the easy ones that he hears all the time. Your money, baby, you know, stuff like that. But anyway, okay. That's where that came from. Just, you know, a little tangent, a little back and forth, letting you know that I'm not just a disgusting pervert, but in fact,
that would be a really good TikTok channel, Just the Tip. And you aren't allowed to explain, you just give the tip and that's it.
That's it.
You're not allowed to explain why that's like the thing you should do. It's just like, here's a tip. All right, done.
Yeah.
Just the tip. I like it.
It's not terrible.
I'm just going to like, just like throw my head into the screen, just like, and then give the tip.
Do this.
And then just like slide down.
Yeah.
That's it.
I do like that. I want to see you be like as non-serious and non-professional as possible. Like, but then something useful is
Have
given.
Have you considered
and then you're just
drinking
like,
with me?
I have considered it, and it's an activity that I try to participate in as much as, you know, our spouses are comfortable with. So,
I mean, I invite my husband along every time.
Yeah,
so.
Yeah, exactly. He's around.
He appreciates
like, that guy again. Seriously, are you sure? He's not even funny. And that's what Daniel says about me.
Speaking of Daniel's comfort, has he left the recliner yet?
We returned it.
Oh, did you?
Wow. It was so heartbreaking. I actually tweeted about this recently, not describing it specifically, but in response to somebody else. So the recliner arrived and we're like, oh yeah, this is great. He's never leaving this. And then he's like, I want you to sit in this seat and tell me if something feels off. No description beyond that. And I'm like, ooh, this sounds fun.
Yeah.
And I sit down. I'm like, I feel like my spine is crooked. Like, I feel like I'm just kind of like leaning a little this way. And he's like, what side? And I said, the right side is sticking out. He's like, exactly. So either we both have crooked spines or something was wrong with the lumbar support in the chair. So we returned it.
And then they didn't try to be like, we can give you a different one. You're just, nah.
So that same chair is on stop order right now for a different issue. So they're like, nope, you can't. But we did order another one that should be arriving hopefully in the next couple of weeks. So we'll try it again.
Yeah,
different store. Apparently Lazy Boy's quality has gone downhill. So we're not ordering from Lazy Boy anymore.
I'm sure there's some funny, ridiculous, quasi-political comment to be made about the global economy. And we just don't pay those kids overseas enough. That's the problem. They'll make better quality once. I don't know.
Somebody's going to read that very wrong. It's fine.
Yeah.
You can just ignore everything that Charles William Carpenter III says. We don't know who he is.
Well, I'm having a real like re-examine of me and what's going on. I'm a guy with big bags under his eyes, but a backwards hat because I think that I'm a teenager. You know, it's a journey. That's what I would say. Nope, I think I lost it. I had a thing and then Robbie interrupted me.
That's it. But.
Unfortunately, we're going to have to wrap things up here because my wife just texted me and needs me to come carry all of this crab up. So
doing your job.
careful with the crabs.
Yes, you do have to be careful with crabs. Before we end, anything else you want to plug or mention, Kelly?
Follow me on Twitter, KVLLY. Follow me or connect with me on LinkedIn. Follow me because I have like 1,400 responded to connections on LinkedIn, but it's my first name and my last name. Yeah, man.
It's hard being popular, isn't it?
You post that you have a, you're hiring for a front end or full stack engineering job, and whew, that's the way to grow your LinkedIn following. That's the secret.
I'll
that's
just it. Lie. Just lie. Yeah. I'm yeah. hiring.
People hiring love that. Like, just for... lead them on and then be yeah, like, yeah. oh, now you're here. So here's what I'm peddling. Great. Yeah,
we need a tasters for Whiskey Web and whatnot.
I mean, maybe. Yeah, I think you should do it. Anything else I should plug? Yeah, I talked about monoleader.is. Tiny Triumphs is tinytriumph.xyz. I'm collecting different TLDs for domains. My personal website is kvlly.com, and the friend zone is thefriendzone.lol.
What country is LOL? Because TLDs a lot of times are attached to countries.
Yeah, who knows?
I don't remember.
Or is
what
it just
was.
The two character ones? Got a little
yeah,
weird
I think,
lately.
I feel like LOL is not a country, but I don't know.
LOL.
Don't they also have like WTF or like, I don't know, a bunch of weird like
they
acronyms?
They do, yeah.
And, yeah.
This one, Namecheap, says buy a .LOL domain name for your fan club, comedy scripts, or collection of funny videos. Give the world something funny to watch or talk about.
Nice.
Okay, so we need whiskey.lol.
Yeah, I want that.
Yes, you do.
Don't buy it. Listen. Cyrus, don't buy it. Also, thank you for the compliments. I have a deep voice when I say tip. But it's just this nice microphone. I'm going to be honest with you.
Oh, my God.
And,
all right. On that note, I got to go get these crabs. So thanks for listening. I haven't read any of the chat. So thanks for anyone who was hanging out. And catch you next time.
Boom, 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 boom.
You've been watching Whiskey Web and Whatnot, recorded in front of a live studio audience.
What the fuck are you talking about, Chuck?
Enjoyed the show? Subscribe.
You know people don't pay attention to these, right?
Head to whiskey.fun for merch and to join our Discord server.
I'm serious. It's like 2% of people who actually click these links.
And don't forget to leave us a 5-star review and tell your friends about the show.
All right, dude. I'm out of here.
Still got it.